today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.
Matitsin is elected new president of FISU and gets support from Thomas Bach. We travel to Sweden where student ice hockey is breaking new ground. The University of Östersund becomes a winter sports centre of excellence and goalkeeper Wang Fei reflects on her career. Oleg Matitsin is the new president of FISU. The Russian, formerly first vice president of the governing body, was elected at the recent 34th General Assembly at the University of Lausanne. No fewer than 128 countries were represented in Switzerland. Matitsin beat incumbent Claude-Louis Gallion of France by 102 votes to 23. 51-year-old Matitsin has headed Russia's delegation at the Universiade for the past 10 years and starts a four-year term. Matitsin explained his objectives at FISU to Campus Sport.
Our philosophy, FISU, organize events, educational sport events, just with one aim, to create the best conditions and to demonstrate unity among students and to demonstrate that we are doing everything for their future. As we say, today stars, tomorrow leaders.
The new president has been involved in the development of student sports for more than 15 years. Matitsin is from Moscow and has an academic background in physical education and administration with a PhD in pedagogical sciences. Matitsin is the vice president of the organizing committee of the 2019 Winter Universiade in Krasnoyarsk. We ask the new man in charge to define his personality.
Professionalism, pleasure, and a future vision. I love life. So this job is pleasure for me. We have to think every day about our children, about our future.
The president of the Russian Sport Union wants more input from continental federations and the National University Sports Federations. He also says that FISU needs to change its global role in an ever-changing world.
The world is changing so fast, and unfortunately not so easy to prognose what will happen tomorrow. But as an organization, international organization, firstly, we have to have the very good information from the countries, from the continent, what is going on there, because we are just governing body. And we, of course, create the vision, create the strategy, but through our membership countries and National University Federation, we could realize our programs.
The new FISU president also wants to strengthen the relationship between FISU and international sports federations and international organizations such as UNESCO. Matitsin has several other priorities. They include women in sport, sustainability, welfare, and the education of young people.
Concerning the welfare program, of course, you know, now many aspects require to be solved. I mean, first of all, doping problem. So we have to educate the young generation how to act, how to be protected from using the doping. We have to be together and through the universities, with Continental Federation, we go directly to as more active as possible on the national level, each university. More and more universities should be involved in our activity.
Matitsin told Campus that he also wants more engagement from young generation and universities. The Russian wants to help youngsters combine a dual career of sport and education.
We need to be very open with them, amongst them, and we have to demonstrate we are as an organization for them. They are part of our organization, but all everything we're doing for them, to create the best conditions for them to realize themselves through the sport, because sport is a unique tool for the, is a, like a model of our life.
Through sport and education, the new FISU president has an ambitious goal of uniting students and nations through sport. Four busy years ahead then for Matitsin. At the first day of the FISU General Assembly, IOC President Thomas Bach gave a welcome address to all participants. The two-time Universiade participant is a perfect illustration of the dual project. He was a student and fencing champion. The IOC president outlined the common values of the two organizations.
The IOC has the Olympic values of excellent friendship and respect, and these values are shared by FISU. And we have one more important thing in common is that we are both very much concerned with education and promoting these values in education, and to make it clear that sport must be and is an important part of a really holistic education. And therefore, we are very pleased of working closely together with FISU.
The IOC recognized FISU more than 50 years ago. Since then, the two organizations have developed an ever closer relationship. The university sports movement supports the IOC's Agenda 2020, and the IOC president wants to foster the partnership.
We are supporting some projects of FISU with regard to development and education. We are also in contact always with regard to the Universiade and the Olympic Games. That means on the more technical level. And I think we can still improve and do more and better with regard to education now that the United Nations have adopted the Sustainable Development Goals and have made it clear that sport is an important tool to reach these Sustainable Development Goals, in particular with regard to education.
To learn lessons and draw conclusions in a changing world, the IOC and FISU looking to work together in the coming years. Next up on Campus Sport, all the best action from the University Hockey League in Sweden. In part three, we also head to the FISU University in Östersund, Sweden, and speak to Chinese goalkeeper Fei Wang.
The International University Sports Federation brings together millions of students worldwide around the same values, excellence in mind and body. Thousands of students, hundreds of universities participate in FISU events, the rendezvous for the best student athletes. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.
Now in February 2015, Russia won the men's ice hockey gold at the Granada Universiade, but Sweden was competing in its second ice hockey tournament since making a comeback at Trento in 2013. That after a 45-year absence. This is where the Swedish Universiade comeback started. The Stockholm Royal University of Technology, and the instigator was a student. Joakim Ronneback Thompson is a student in industrial engineering and management, and in 2012 created the UHL, the first university hockey league in Sweden.
It has been a long night, you know, hard work, volunteering for this league, but it's so fun. You know, you get so much back when you're skating out to on the ice, when you have you know, the crowd and the yelling, screaming, the university name, and you know, in some games here in Stockholm and in Lund, we have a crowd up against 400 to 500 people coming to every game. So that's pretty amazing, and we see a great interest in college sports here.
He came here the first year. He started the team here at school, and at the same time he started the UHL and got the game started with the universities here. And I think it's great. He's done a lot of work, and I don't know if the guys here in our team can imagine how much work he put into this and to get all this together. And we're so so glad that he got this all this energy to make it happen.
This is lots of volunteering work, of course. Every university create their own home games. I try to manage the schedule, and we try to sell tickets to the games, to have some ice time and, you know, training sessions. Hopefully in the future we'll see UHL as an association with paid employees, and maybe from there we can develop it and try to really compete with the best nation in university sports.
The UHL allows Sweden to select its best players for international tournaments and face leading nations like Canada, the USA and Russia. Its future lies in recognition from the powerful National Federation of Ice Hockey.
We haven't yet recognized by the Swedish Ice Hockey Association yet, but that's something we have to improve and try to get them on board to increase the league. But so far it's so good. We have five universities participating this year, and last year four universities, so we try to develop the league all the time.
While studying at university in Sweden is free, there's a funding problem for the UHL in such a large country. Travelling from Chalmers in Gothenburg to Stockholm takes 6 hours by car, and that's short compared to a trip to Umeå in Lapland.
By train it's almost 20 hours, and by flight about 4 or 5. But we can't afford the flight, so it will. Hopefully, we can meet halfway somewhere in Sweden and play the game. But that's for the spring. We have to plan for that.
Right now, we don't have the economics to travel up to Umeå, and it's a real shame because I know some of the guys there, and they're gonna have a really good team. So I really hope we can pull it together and find a way to make this league a big thing in Sweden.
Now in the UHL, players have to pay for everything themselves: sports equipment, travel, referees and rinks. For some universities, merely finding facilities can be tough.
Here in Gothenburg, it's very hard to find the stadium to play in. And we have worked very hard now and got some ice time for the UHL this year. Last year we had to play in the spring after the season because it's full. Every stadium is full all the season.
Chalmers University are the UHL vice champion, but resources are thin. The team coach is also one of the players.
We had a lucky break that I'm injured this year. Lucky for them, unlucky for me, but oftentimes you have to pick a player just to be a playing coach. This year I'm injured, so I stepped up and took the role.
Nevertheless, Chalmers students seem to have no regrets about spending so much time on the ice.
I think it's pretty good to have something on the side from the studies, because you can keep the mind on something else. And when I train, I can stay focused for a longer period of time in class and off class.
Even though you stay in school like 8 hours a day, then you, even with exams, like you go down to the rink and like you can drop everything else, and you have 2-3 hours where you just don't think about that at all. So it's really good for like relaxation for the brain.
Sweden's UHL is getting more attention and has the support of the country's University Sport Federation.
It's a win-win situation. We have players on different level that will take part in ice hockey, physical activity. They will have sort of a social is good. I mean, socially they can meet, they have sort of fun, and they can also be representing Sweden in the Universiade.
A final word from Thompson at the KTH Royal Institute of Technology in Stockholm. The team captain has high hopes for student hockey, but is playing the long game.
Right now, we are not recognized by the Swedish Ice Hockey Association, and that's why we don't get funded from them. But hopefully in the future, they will recognize us, and then we can be a part of the association. And by that, we also get funded by them to participating in the Universiade. But I don't think we can manage that to the 2017 Universiade in Kazakhstan. But hopefully in 2019 we can manage it.
Student ice hockey on the rise in Sweden then. Look out for Thompson and his teammates in Almaty 2017. Next, we ask how to combine academic study and high-level sports performance. Östersund in central Sweden could have the answer. And we hear from FISU hero Fei Wang, a goalkeeper from China and a Universiade champion from French team Lyon.
The International University Sports Federation brings together millions of students worldwide around the same values, excellence in mind and body. Thousands of students, hundreds of universities participate in FISU events, the rendezvous for the best student athletes. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.
Central Sweden is the site of one of the most successful universities in the world of sport. Östersund is around 80 kilometers from mountains and the Åre ski resort, which has hosted top-level alpine skiing competitions. The city of Östersund is in the heart of snowy plains and frozen lakes, which also host World Cup biathlon and cross-country skiing competitions, attracting stars from around the world. The city's university targets top sports performances from its students. Unlike the vast majority of universities around the world, this is an establishment that adapts itself to the demands of elite sport and allows its athletes to be successful students.
This university, Mid-Sweden University, has been doing a lot of work with athletes, world-class athletes. And for example, we have 25 years of experience to combine study with elite sport. And here's a good example, Anna Ottosson, who became bronze medalist in Olympics in Turin 2006, graduated the same year in business here at the school.
Indeed, the university has an impressive hall of fame with former students on Olympic and World Cup podiums. Flexibility in teaching is the key.
They can choose whatever they want to read and study. And then we set up sort of a flexible solution for each student, for each athlete. If they are away for many days, they can come back and we can give them extra support, extra lectures. We can give them a possibility to do their, if they have sort of a test, they can do that in rope holding if they are there.
You can kind of adapt the schedule as you want it. And right now I am going full speed, 100% with the school. And I don't know how long I will do that. I will do it this year, maybe go down to 75% next year, but we'll see what I do. And you can adapt your schedule as you want it.
Campus Sport met Bjorn Sandström, a cross-country skier who dreams of a place in the Swedish national team. He's one of 40 top-level athletes who form part of a 5,000-strong student setup in Östersund.
As some people understand, some people don't understand what are you doing. I mean, I show up in class, but they don't know that I've already been awake for 4 hours before class that starts at 10 and working out. But I don't know. You can call me mentally ill or something, but I kind of like it. I like kind of being stressed out.
Success doesn't come easily. The university has built a winter sports centre, which includes a laboratory for analysis and research of sports performance. The lab is used by students and national team members, many of whom visit Östersund twice a year. Here's test leader Andreas Karlström.
We have the theoretical, where we have the practical results. And how is the next step for improvement? If we do testing in an athlete, and we can see just before a season, the coach can get some direct feedback. Okay, are the athletes in shape? Have we trained what we're supposed to before a season? You can help to adjust and adapt the training before the season starts.
Östersund even has a hypoxic chamber, which simulates altitude and temperature. The system allows athletes to quickly adapt to changes in altitude and improve physical performance. This can give Östersund students a big advantage in training, as Alex Patrician explains.
Campus is just outside, so you can go from a campus lecture, training out at the stadium, and then you come in here to 5,000 meters or 2,000 meters, negative 15 degrees, and have a training session.
When it comes to training, Östersund students have another unique facility. A stadium less than 1 kilometer from the university has hosted World Cup and World Championship biathlon and cross-country skiing events. Students like Mona Brorson are prepared to make sacrifices to make the most of the facilities.
As I focusing on the skiing and staying healthy and all that part, so I can't really be part of the student life. Parties and so that doesn't work, and it's very good for me to be able to have my lessons from home, because then I don't have to meet a lot of people and of course a lower risk of becoming sick.
It's long days and hard days. You first go to train at the morning, 2-3 hours, and then lunch, the school, and then more training.
The university's culture is also reflected in coaching, which also needs to be flexible and have an eye on the future.
I think it's very good that they show also some of the top athletes that you can combine with students also. So they have something, I mean, the athletes, the career is not forever. You can see the end. I mean, often we have some that are over 40, but normally you start another life, and then it's good to have something more.
The new biathlon World Cup season starts in Östersund. Its university student athletes will certainly feel at home.
I'm Mei Zhuangfei, goalkeeper of Li'an and the nationality of China.
This month's FISU hero won the gold medal with China at the Universiade of 2011.
Hey, welcome to my place.
How is my life in here every day? Yeah.
After playing one season in Potsdam in Germany, Fei Wang moved to Li'an last September. She now plays for one of Europe's top teams, Li'an. Our FISU hero has made history. She's the first Chinese student footballer to play in Europe. How much pressure does that put on her?
I don't think this is pressure, but I think it's good. If I have the first one, maybe, yeah, then can have more come here, and Chinese football will be improved, I think.
Fei Wang was born in Dalian in northeast China. She's the eldest of two girls in the family. Fei Wang considered becoming a model before opting to pursue a career in football and teach herself English.
I will go to the university to learn some English. I think it will be better for me, improve my English. In China, I told the players, if you want to play in Europe, and please first start learning English. That is so important.
Let's go to the training. Okay, let's go.
Fei Wang has a huge challenge in Li'an, whose team has stars from France, Sweden, Norway, Germany, Japan, and now China. Initially a forward, she explained her decision to switch position.
2003, I started playing football in the school. In the beginning, I don't like to be a goalkeeper. I would like to be a striker. Yeah. And my coach say I will get taller, and he think yeah, it's good for me to be goalkeeper. In this time, no one wants to be goalkeeper on the team. So I take the job to be goalkeepers. Yeah.
Fei Wang came to prominence at the 2011 Universiade in Shenzhen. The Universiade proved a special time for Fei, who was still a student at the time.
I think in the 2011 is very important. It changed my life, changed my football, I think.
And Fei Wang's life changed after the semi-finals in the southern Chinese city. She became a hero after saving two penalties in the semi-final shootout against Brazil.
In the penalty, I was so good. I was on the university this time. Yeah, I was in the future, I was not sure I can be a very good player. Yeah? But after this game, it changed my whole life, I think. Yeah.
In a memorable final, China came from behind to beat Japan 2-1 in extra time. Chan Li finally won the gold medal after an 18-year wait.
I think it's a great final, but I get a lot of pressure during the final game. I can remember it because I don't want to again have a penalty, you know. But at the end, we win it.
Fei Wang's career has gone from strength to strength. Last summer, she went to the World Cup as China's number one. The Steel Roses reached the quarterfinals before losing to the eventual winners, the USA. A huge disappointment for the goalkeeper, who's already looking ahead to 2019.
After the World Cup this year, I was go home and watch the Japan and the American the game, and the American get champion, and I was sad. I was crying at home, and I was thinking I want to play in 5 years more. I want to try again in the World Cup. Yeah.
That narrow 1-0 defeat to the Americans still hurts. But when it comes to 2019, Lyon goalkeeper Fei Wang couldn't be in a better country, with France hosting the next World Cup.
I hope to see you again, 2019, the World Cup in Lyon. Okay, bye.
Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.